Thank you. So I'm supposed to say something about GABA. So he likes to do technical things, and he even liked to do almost mathematics when nobody else didn't want wanted to touch it. So I want to talk, well, about Arakhilov geometry, which is an old topic. So if you have a curve over the integers of a number field, then you want to do an intersection theory for divisors, and you need an intersection number at infinity. Infinite places. And this is done if you have PQ in the complex. You want the intersection number to be minus log GPQ. Where GPQ is something like, sort of log of big G, big PQ. Where GPQ is something like the distance between P and Q. So if P and Q are close, then the distance is small and minus the log is big. And so they should have big intersection. And of course, so GPQ. Is sort of norm 1, PQ, or metric. And O of delta, where delta C is a diagonal. Okay, and of course there are many such choices. And Arakhilov made the choice that if you have a measure mu, there are many such metrics, but at least for such metrics, we know something. We know that the curvature is a 1-1 form which represents the class of the diagonal, and so it's restricted. And Arakhilov said if we choose a measure mu, mu a 1-1 form, and the integral, well, now C has become a Riemann surface, is 1. Then we look at Hermitian line bundles. So, Hermitian.
Is it a positive 1-1
form? In the moment, it doesn't have to be. With curvature is degree L times mu. So we know that the curvature integral gives a degree. So if it's a multiple of mu, it has to be this multiple. And we look at the line bundle, which we call admissible matrix. So admissible matrix. And then we know that such a metric is unique up to scaling. Okay, and so the GPQ should give a metric on the diagonal of, or if I restrict one factor, on O of Q. And then, if one requires that these metrics are admissible, then there's a unique, so there's a unique metric, unique up to scalar, scaling, take on O of delta. With curvature uh, maybe I had mu tensor 1 plus 1 tensor mu minus some alpha j 1 and then if I change this on the diagonal alpha, I hope I got this right. Yeah, the alpha j are an orthonormal basis. No, sorry, this has to be. Basis of. This is true because sort of this is the harmonic representatives for the diagonal. And okay, and if we have such a metric, we get a metric on the differentials. So then get metric on differentials. Maybe write omega c by the fact that this is O. Delta. And the curvature of this metric is gotten. I take the negative of this and restrict this to the diagonal. And if we want this metric to be admissible, so the curvature is a twice minus 2 nu. And if we want this to be admissible, I think I should put a factor
there
I.
There is a problem with real alpha wedge.
Yes, I should put a factor I over 2 for the inner product. But and so this is admissible if mu is a multiple of this. So if mu is I over 2g times some alpha j bar. And this is called the Arakilov measure. So Arakilov. And well, if one does this, one can do some things. For example, one can define volumes forms. So one can define, volume forms. On R gamma CL. If L has an admissible matrix, which sort of satisfies the obvious thing, and sort of determinant of this one, which satisfy obvious scaling condition, and also if one has short exact sequences, one gets something. And this is up to scalar. And then up to scalar. And again, we can normalize the volume forms that sat on the omega, on the differential. It's sort of, given by the square integral. So normalize. Square integral. Differentials. And then one knows that on line on L of degree g minus 1, so if L has degree e minus 1. Then this is independent of scaling because we get a power of the Euler-Poincaré characteristic, which is 0. And then this determinant is sort of O of minus theta. So the determinant is isomorphic to O of minus theta on the Jacobian.
What, can you explain again, what did you say about independent of scaling?
Then the metric here, if you have a line bundle of degree g minus 1, which is an admissible metric,
yes,
then on the determinant of cohomology, it's independent of scaling because you get a power the Euler characteristic.
But to define the metric on the determinant of cohomology, what do you use the correction by the analytic torsion or
not? No, while it's... Well, it can be written as the square integral and correction by analytic torsion, but I use a different one. I use sort of, if you have a line bundle, okay, L of if you have an admissible line bundle and a point, you have this exact sequence. And this thing has a metric. And so the difference of cohomology of these two has a metric. And I require that this is compatible. And this...
So you need a metric on L minus P.
Well, I require on the... this also has a metric because O of minus P is a metric given by the
by Akhilov.
And then you want this to be compatible, and this gives you essentially a metric on the O of D's, where D is a divisor. And then you show that it factors over the isomorphism class. And it's enough to do this for degree g minus 1. And for this one, well, I mean, there you have no scaling problems. And for this one, you compute the curvature of this metric. And you show that it's induced from the Jacobian.
You mean the curvature is a form on the curve?
No, the curve, I mean, if you have O of a divisor, then the curvature is... So the divisor is parameterized by C to some big number.
Yes.
Then it's a 1-1 form on C to this big number.
Yes.
So it can be written well.
Yes.
And you can compute this curvature. And you see that it's induced from the Jacobian.
Yes.
Okay, does this answer your question?
And so this shows that you that your rule specifies a choice of matrix and the determinant.
Yes.
Once you, but this, for all line bundles is an admissible metric.
Yes.
And so there is a unique choice on the category of those things.
Yes.
Up to a scalar.
Yes.
Up to a common scalar.
Yes.
And so you don't get rid of the common scalar.
No, you have the omega.
Okay, you know
the H1 of omega is canonically trivial.
Okay.
Okay. Yeah, so you have this one, and then you from the curvature, then you see that the volume is sort of, I mean, that the log volume is proportional to minus log of norm of the theta function. So on the Jacobian of degree g minus 1, you have the canonical theta function, and you can normalize it, for example, that the square integral is 1 or whatever. And then, so it's up to a constant, plus a constant. And this constant I call, so define, minus delta over 8. So this is, delta is just a real number, which is an invariant of the Riemann surface. And I call it this way, this strange way, because of the following.
So theta is the log absolute value of theta is what? Is the
you take the theta function and it has a canonical, well, it has a norm with invariant. I mean, the O of theta has a norm with invariant curvature, and you can and so the log theta, so the norm of theta is determined up to a factor, and you can normalize it such that the square integral is 1, and then you get a value for this one.
The square integral of the section, of which section?
Of theta, of the, I mean of the norm of theta. If you multiply the norm by a scalar, then the square integral is also multiplied. And then if you
normal the norm of O of theta, in O of theta, okay.
Yeah. Okay, so you have this one. And then you can prove for arithmetic surfaces,
and then measure on J, G minus 1 is normalized so that the volume is
1, for example, yeah. From arithmetic surfaces, you get the Riemann-Roch theorem. And you get a sort of Noether formula. That the arithmetic genus is sort of omega squared plus delta over 12, let's say for semi-stable. Where omega is sort of the relative differentials or the dualizing sheaf with the admissible metric. And you have this omega squared by the Arakhilov theory. And delta is a sum. So delta is a sum of all places, delta V. Well, at finite places, you said, maybe I write log QV times delta V plus some, I mean, plus infinite. And the delta V is a number of singularities over V. So if you have a semi-stable curve, then generically it's smooth, but there are finitely many singular fibers, and there you have double points. And well, if you have a regular semi-stable model, you count the number of points, or if you have a stable model, you count with multiplicity, and you get this one.
And you also count the number of geometric points, or the number of...
Well, okay, you would have to look at the extension field, okay.
And when you have real and complex places, does it influence what the formula that is you take the sum of embeddings in C, that is twice?
Yes, yes. Yeah, and then you get the sum, it's sort of sum of this over this infinite places.
Sorry, is the delta the same in both places?
Which delta?
Of delta on the first line.
No, no, delta is an invariant of Riemann surface. And in all infinite places you have different Riemann surfaces and you have invariance delta. And the sum occurs here.
But the complex conjugate has the same delta, I think.
Yes. Okay. And then the question was, well, this suggests that the delta, that the infinite places, the delta should somehow measure the singularities at infinity. And then the question was, is delta related to to a metric. On, I take the moduli stack and of all semi-stable curve, and I look at the divisor which gives the singular curves, and whether there's a metric, so there should be something like log of the norm of one or something. So this is this is the problem I wanted to solve. And for this one, I study degenerations. So this means if I have a Riemann surface and if it approaches the boundary, I want to look what happens. So study.
So you use the quantification?
Yes. So if I have a family of Riemann surfaces, C over S.
By the way, G here is at least 2, or it can be 1, or what is the...
I think G can be 1, but it shouldn't be 0.
And in the case of 0, do you get anything, what you wrote make sense for G equals 0 or not?
No, it doesn't make, because you have to divide by G for the Akilov measure.
Oh, yeah, okay.
I think it seems to be related to the fact that you have minimal models in genus bigger equal 1. Okay, and so you have a fiber C0. And you want to study the Arakilov. Want to study. Asymptotic behavior of Arakilov. Data. And I should say, if I have a curve C0, I get a graph gamma, which corresponds vertices of E. So these are the irreducible components. Of C0. And these are the double points. And an edge joins two irreducible components if the double point lies in between them. And I usually orient the edges, so but I won't say this here. And then sort of each, so for small s, so each fiber is a union of maybe C0V, union C0S, C0E, where these are sort of curves with disks removed. And these are sort of annuli. So I do a picture, so you have several curves. And they are sort of their annuli. Maybe there is a different curve here. And it may go on and whatever. And so the degeneration happens if these annuli are squeezed. So squeezed. And well, okay, and so, and so to do the asymptotics and variant, I consider them either sort of on these components or on the annuli, which means I sort of write something distinguished between them. And the annuli have equation u times v equal te, let's say, and u v less equal 1. And sort of in the TE are parameters which measure the singularity, and I assume that they are small. And usually I also take the invariant log minus log of TE, I call SE, so that I don't have to write negative numbers too often. Okay? And then, well, and then I look at the GPQs. Well, sorry, this is so the picture I will need later. And I look at the GPQs. Let's say where P and Q are points either in the same or in different components and which behave nicely. And then I look at the asymptotics. And asymptotics means I want to study them on the curve up to a uniformly bounded function. So asymptotics means up to bounded uniformly in S bounded function. And then this means sort of up to a function, it means I sort of need a reference model for these GPQs, which is sort of standard. I mean, well, if P lies here and Q lies there, then I want that there's sort of a local equation times something and so on.
So you allow also a component which intersects itself, I suppose, in the special fiber.
Yeah, but then sort of it has an edge, yeah. Okay, if you... Yeah, yeah. Up to a bounded function, and the result will be but they are sort of constant, I mean, depending on S. So the result would be that they are sort of constant. So constant depending on S. S and V on the curves, on the interior of the curve. Meaning, I guess that it has bounded variation on them. And on the annuli, so on annuli, so mostly, maybe I write linear interpolation. By which I mean sort of it's a linear function in log u or log v. So in this coordinates, so the one linear interpolation, and so so if this is always the case, then sort of the interesting function are given by the values on the components. But there's one exception. So one exception
But when you say constant on C0V means on, when the two points line the same C0V?
Then
or one point in one and the other in another? Or?
No, no. I mean, well, it's well, it's both is true. I mean,
but constant up to bounded function is the same as zero. So, so this is what you mean, that is it's uniformly bounded,
yeah,
in your sense?
No, no, not but no, but the constant depends on the parameter s. And the bounded function is bounded uniformly in S.
Ah, okay. Constant, namely function of S and V.
Yeah.
And when you
this, but this why I wrote depending on S and V.
Ah, okay, okay. And then when you have points in one in C0V and the other in C0W, then it depends on S, V and W?
Yes.
Okay.
So one exception, if you have the same annulus, so if you have the annulus cos, well, if you have the same one, then it's not bilinear, but there's a correction term, and so correction term. So. So I write this thing also maybe, usually it's about the minimum of P times 1 minus Q and Q times 1 minus P. One. So I mean these coordinates log U, they sort of go from 0 to 1 on both of them. And I get the correction term, which is a multiple of this one, which is nonlinear in P and Q. And this, I think, is related to the fact that if you consider the diagonal, then on the product of two annuli, this is not a Cartier divisor, and you have to do a blow up. And this way you get this one.
What is the P and Q?
P and Q are the coordinates on the, well, sort of this log U, which I did write. Where did I write this? Linear interpolation.
So the linear interpolation means that, let us say, one point is in the annulus and one point is in the interior, and then you get a
linear. No, no, I mean, so the log U I normalize so that it runs from 0 to 1, and the log V also. And then I call this P and Q, and then I get this multiple of this function.
You get, yeah, but when you say the linear interpolation before the exception stuff, so
yes,
what does it mean? It means we are referring to the case where one point is in an annulus and one point is not.
No, no, I refer to the fact that both points are in the same annulus.
No, but before, I was asking three lines above this.
Yes?
When you write the linear interpolation.
Yeah, I said, I mean, that the function depends linearly on the interpolation. I mean, this is also allowed if two are in the same annulus, except that I have this correction.
Okay, you interpolate between the two edges of the
annulus. Yeah, yes.
And so if you have two points in different annuli, also do this.
Yes, game. Yeah.
Okay.
And so there's this one correction term.
This implies so if you have an annulus between, let's say, component A, component B, another one between component C and component D, there are four numbers originally, like in this. So when you want to interpolate linearly,
then you want a bilinear function, and this you have to know on the four ends, on the four corners.
By also with, okay.
Yeah.
X, Y, okay. The product of the two, okay.
Yeah. Okay. So I got. So this is the result, and well, this is related to this. And well, and the things and these values are sort of given by the graph. So then it's given by graph. By the graph. So they can be computed from the graph G. And okay, so maybe how do you do this computation? So how do you compute the Arakelov of these? This can be done as follows. If you have a Riemann surface, and you have 2 points, you have a sort of harmonic function. HPQ of Z, which is sort of poles, so we have sort of poles with residues plus minus one. This means it's sort of near these points. If I do a local coordinates, it's asymptotical like plus or minus like z. And this is unique up to a constant. And how do you get this? You take alpha pq, a differential U with residues plus minus one. This you know. And then it's unique up to adding holomorphic differentials. And you can require to have purely imaginary periods. Periods. Because if you have holomorphic differentials, you can prescribe the imaginary parts of the sort of the real parts of the periods, and you can subtract this. So you have this one, and then you take the HPQ, you take sort of the infinite indefinite integral of alpha PQ. So this is unique up to a constant, and because all the sort of the real part of this, I forgot. So the real part is independent of the path because your residues are there. And then you have this GPQ, maybe GP of Z. I'm sorry. So you take the integral. Maybe, sorry, z of q. Well, I think it's this one. You take the integral of hpq of z times the mu of p plus a constant. And the constant is sort of such that the mu integral is zero. So integral over nu. So
the graph is gamma or g, or gamma there and g, is it is the same?
Oh, sorry, yeah, that's the same. Okay. I guess the letters are not that different.
So the g, z, so q is fixed. No.
Yeah. Yeah, I integrate over one variable and.
No, what does it? Z is a variable? How do you
integrate? Z is a variable. PQ depends on three variables, on P and Q, and on the variable Z.
Okay, and you take
HPQ is. So the HPQ is sort of curvature delta P minus delta Q. And if you integrate over P, then you get curvature mu minus delta Q. So you have sort of something like curvature, which is the right curvature for the GPQ. And then you have to add a constant to make the mu integral equal to zero.
Mu integral relative to z or?
What? Yeah, well, you could do any, you could, for example, do the integral over z. Or you could also do the integral over q.
For a fixed z.
Yeah.
And the both conditions are equivalent.
Yes. So this one, and so this is how I got this, and now I have to talk about the how I do this on a degenerate curve. So first of all, I have to know something about the Arakhelov measure. So. So on C0, on the fiber, I have the differentials, and I have either the differentials which have no poles at the double points. So this is the gamma CV omega CV. Then omega. Well, and then I have the residues. I have sort of the C to the edges. I have the residues at these. And now.
So, by the way, more rigorously, so the notion of a graph is like in Serre's book, that is, you have the set of edges is really some, you have a surface in involution, so it depends, because you need the retention.
Yes, yes.
And you have the, so when you write this, you have to take this into account, because you have the...
Well, I said you orient all edges.
Ah, okay.
Yeah.
In some way.
Okay. I don't know how it is in Serre's book, but...
No, he has some set of edges in involution to change the direction of the...
So, talking about the graph, I forgot
the
one thing.
The notion of what the graph is, because this, if you look at different books, what they say is a graph, slightly different depending on what you read. So,
unoriented multigraph.
What?
Unoriented multigraph is, I think, the nicest thing to use.
But I say it's oriented. And it's no multigraph, it's a single graph. Well, for the graph, I have the homology. I have a map from Z to the E to Z to the vertices, which is the E. Well, and the kernel I call X, which is H1 of G. Oh, what did I say? I had this gamma Z. And the co-kernel and usually I call this differential D. And and the residues of a differential are lie in X to the R. So this maps over X, C. And then it's exact. This is because if you look at the sum of the residues on a component, then it's zero. And this means just that this is the boundary. So the boundary map sends the edge to a plus or to the two endpoints, the difference of the two endpoints, and because I had the edge oriented. Well, you can figure out whether you want the beginning minus the end or the end minus the beginning. Okay, so I have this one. And so, well, so the differentials form a nice family. Well, and there's a similar on the singular fibers, you have this residue map. So it degenerates so on each. So there is a residue maps, and then you get a basis of differentials. You get a differentials on the curves, and you get differentials which have non-trivial residues. So then you have a so the co-kernel is isomorphic to this one, and then if you do the square integral of a differential, so if you do the square integral. Then if the differential is holomorphic on doesn't have poles, then it's about the square integral on the component. But if it has poles, then the square integral is sort of concentrated on the annuli. And so it's about the sum of SE times residue E squared. So if you integrate well, over an annulus, you get somehow this one if you look at the residue. So by the way, the residue is defined also on the other fibers by sort of integrating once around the loop here. Okay?
An integral of what?
Of a one form.
Is the sum of
so if you want to integrate du over u squared over this annulus, then you sort of take polar coordinates, then you get 2 pi times integral maybe of log te to 1. You get, what is it? Dx over x, and dx over x, and this gives you 2 pi minus 2 pi times log t. And the other terms, so in the differential, the u over u term is the one which gives the, which dominates the integral, and you get this one.
So here you are doing the integral kind of in a family over the moduli.
Yes, yes.
You choose a lifting of something in the special, a section of the canon of the dualizing sheaf on the special fiber, you extend it to.
Yeah, I mean on the other fiber I still have a residue map by doing this integral, and I can do the square integral, well, and I can have a nice algebraic family over my base S, because the omega is a vector bundle, and I can take a basis near S, and then I get a basis of the differentials on each curve, and it has a map, a residue map to this X, and the kernel sort of I can also consider, and for something in the kernel, the square integral is about the square integral over the components, and for something and for the residue, then the square integral is dominated by this one, because I assume that the SE are big, meaning I want to look at the asymptotics if I get close to the singular curve.
So, by the way, I don't understand. You have this exact sequence.
Yes.
To C to D, but then you want to look. What do you say about the X? You say that the
X is a space of loops in the graph.
Yeah, but what is the relation to the
X lies in C to the E because the kernel lies in this one.
You claim that this is the image of the residue map?
What? Yeah, it's the image of the residue map in this X. Okay, and so, I want to find an orthonormal basis, and then I get an orthonormal basis. I sort of take a basis for the inner product on X. So I get an orthonormal basis. I take an orthonormal basis for X with a norm XE. So XE squared this one, and I take an orthonormal basis for gamma CV omega CV, and then I sort of get an orthonormal basis of the whole space by combining them. And while I can sort of lift them, I mean, if the SE become big, then the XE becomes small, and then I can sort of lift them that they are small on these components. So the integral is like this, and so this gives me an orthonormal basis. So it gives an orthonormal basis, and then the Arakhilov. Okay, so this is one thing. Then I have to define these HPQs. So I have to find alpha PQ.
What is the last comment? Plus Arakhilov.
I get the Arakhilov measure if I know an orthonormal basis.
So here it's an orthonormal basis for over in the family of the space of differentials.
Yeah.
But
well, I.
What do you mean? You get the. The Arakhilov view is on the fiber.
On the fiber CS.
Yes. So what is the?
So the Arakhilov mu has sort of some part which lies in these components and some part which is concentrated on the annuli, and the rest is sort of small. And on the component, I sort of get the Arakhilov measure of these curves, except I have to multiply with the genus divided to. By the total genus, because for the Arakhilov measure, I have this 1 over g.
And what kind of stability or semi-stability you have on the family? I mean, about genus zero components, you assume something or not?
I mean, the genus zero, well, on the genus zero components, the gv is zero, so the Arakhilov measure is sort of zero, the component. And then I get an additional contribution which sort of lives on these annuli, and this is sort of controlled by this X with this inner product.
Yeah, but anyway, sometimes when they do the generation of curves, they assume like the stability condition, the rational curve is at least 3 singular. Do you assume something like this, or does things break down when you?
I think certainly semi-stable is enough, but I standing up, I don't want to Well, I guess semi-stable is enough, so, but otherwise I don't want to commit myself out of hand. Yeah. Okay, so we have to find these alpha PQs, and you sort of can find nice algebraic families. Let's say if you have 2 points PQ, well, I don't, in there you can find nice algebraic families, but you need the condition that the periods are purely imaginary. So how to get? Purely imaginary. And sort of the periods are sort of, I mean, the filtration, there are sort of three types. One is sort of the loops around the annuli. The second one is sort of loops in here, in the curve CV. And the third one are sort of periods which come if you, which correspond to loops in gamma. So, I think I called this gamma now, not G. Yeah? And sort of, I mean, and the integrals over this one are the residues. So I want that the residues should be real. So the residues, sort of 2 pi I times residues at E should be real. Then you have these interior loops. And this by you can sort of correct by adding differentials on the curves, which have no poles. And they're sort of unique. So interior loops at alpha CV. And then they are sort of the most intrinsic one are the loops in X. So loops in X. While in the graph gamma, which correspond to X. So I said I have a differential with given residue. And I can lift them uniquely that their interior periods are purely imaginary. So lift X to differentials with purely imaginary maybe I write interior loop, interior periods. And then, well, and sort of, I also should, so this is sort of the residue should be in the real base extension of X. And then the loop, well, and then I want to add such differentials. And because the interior periods are purely imaginary, I don't destroy what I've already achieved. So this is good. And the integral about a loop is sort of is a linear form on the xe. So integral around loop. is a linear form on X. And it differs from the sum R. So it differs from so sum S E times X E times Y E. So I have a bilinear form on X by bounded function by a bounded bilinear form.
You have a
bilinear form on X cross X, where one X describes the loop and the other X describes the differential. And then you get the integral around the loop, and this gives you a bilinear form. And the integral is sort of dominated by the integral around the interiors of the loops, which sort of give you these terms. And then there is sort of the integral, which sort of fits this part, which goes from one end from the loop to the other, but this is bounded. So this is a small function. Okay. And then you want this form to be zero. So we have a linear form on X, and you have this non-degenerate inner form, and then you sort of can. No, sorry. This I said wrong. I was too far. So I have had my candidate alpha pq, which I fixed in the first step, that in the interior loops it has purely imaginary periods, and then I take these more complicated loops and I take the real parts of these integrals, and these form a linear form. And then for X, so for X, good. So this is linear form, and I want to subtract something from X to make this zero, because I want the real parts to be zero.
So yeah, are you taking now, you're working on the complex or the real? X is over which, is it XC or XR or?
No, I mean, I have only real parts because I want this condition zero, that the around the loops at the edges, the integral is purely imaginary. So I want an X with real residues. Then I take my alpha, my candidate for a form, which I have to correct by adding some form parameterized by X. And the real part of the integral around loops in X gives me a linear form on X. Yeah. And this linear form comes from X. X itself gives linear forms, which are about this one plus a bounded function. Yes. And so this means I can correct it by this, by sort of taking the orthogonal projection from a linear form. This linear form is determined by inner product with an element of X, and then the correction is this one plus a bounded, some bounded term, uniformly in X. So this gives me
five more minutes.
I don't know whether answering question is added. like in soccer. So this way you can construct your differential HBQ and sort of, and these orthogonal projections are given by the graph, and then you can compute the GPQ, and then you can compute all invariants. So since I'm supposed to finish, I should say, and the final result is, so the final result is that sort of the interesting invariants are rational functions, or the interesting like invariants are rational functions. A sort of homogeneous rational function. In the homogeneous of degree one, one in the SE. So this means to the values of these G's on the component, and also to the for the delta function. But unfortunately, they are not linear forms. So, unfortunately, so delta is not a linear combination. Combination of the SE. And so this means there's no metric on the O, on the boundary O of the boundary of the moduli space, which gives this delta function. So doesn't. At least you can compute things, yeah. Oh, I should say I have a student, Robert Wilms, who was supposed to do this, but he did something else, which happens with some of my students, which was also very good, so I had to do it myself.
Are there questions, perhaps from someone other than Ofer? Ofer, I'm sure, has questions.
Mark, can you say, in this case where you have the, what you call the linear interpolation?
Yes.
So one of the points is on the annuli.
Yes.
Where can the other point really be to get a contribution?
Well, it could be anywhere.
But how do you, I mean, is there some intuition behind that? They seem, because they seem like even in the limit kind of far apart, right?
Well, I mean, if you have linear interpolation, it's enough to have points on the different components. Mm-hmm. And for the components, for the graph, there is something, there's sort of, I had this to d to the v, I had a d, and I have an adjoint. And I can also scale the inner product, well, it's his natural inner product, so scale. Product YS. And then you sort of get a Laplace operator. And there's a similar thing, sort of, if you have a, now, you have a sort of Arakelov measure here. So you have sort of, you put a G V over G on V, and then you sort of in the edges, and on the edges, you sort of, you have a certain measure, and you sort of divide it equally between the two ends. So you get a certain measure, and then you sort of want to solve a Green's function. You want to solve the equation delta. Delta of G is sort of a point minus P, mu minus P, I should say. So the mu is total measure 1, and if you have a point also, then you can, then this is total measure 0, so it's the image of the Laplace operator, and this gives you a Green's function on the graph, and the asymptotic of the Green's function is essentially given by this one. As I said, it's sort of computed by the graph.
We are going to resume at 5 to 12, but let's thank Faltings again.